I have a very special guest. Her name is Dawn Stone. Keep your weapon at
your side, your arm. She was doing the ultrasound, and she's like, "You're having twins." And, of course, we were so excited. I could see the concern on her face that something wasn't quite right. Living with one foot in heaven.
Welcome to Heritage of Truth. Today I have a very special guest. Her name is Dawn Stone. She is a mom and a wife, and she is a photographer. Welcome, Dawn.
Hi, Jean. Thank you for having me.
I'm really excited to have you. Now, you and your family have a very dramatic story. Why don't you take us back to the time when you had two children and you found out you were expecting?
We've been married back then. It was, about 15 years, and we went back and forth about having more kids and then just decided to have another one. And then I'd prayed for twins, actually, because I didn't want to have one child kind of by themselves. So I prayed for twins. And then we went in. Well, I told my doctor, I kept telling her, you want to do an ultrasound? I really think I'm having twins. And because things were so different with this pregnancy. She's like, no, you're not measuring big. And no, you're not having twins. So then I come in for my 20-week ultrasound, super excited because I just know I'm having twins. And then so we're in there, and my two older children were in there as well as my mom. My husband wasn't there because he had just started a new job. And so she was doing the ultrasound, and she's like, you're having twins. And, of course, we were so excited. My son actually put his head, he was 14 at the time, he just put his head in his hands and just kind of shook his head because she told him they were twin girls. So he found out he was the only boy. that was like a moment I'll never forget. But the more she looked at him, I could see the concern on her face that something wasn't quite right. And so she didn't really say anything, and she went and got the doctor and came in. And my doctor was like, you were right. I can't believe it. You are having twins. And then I went back in there with my regular doctor. She told me that I had a rare syndrome. The girls had a rare syndrome. It was called twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome. And didn't go into great detail, but basically she said the chances of both of them making it are very slim if either one of them make it at all.
Mm.
So then, I was so excited. I was having twins. God answered my prayers, and then you couldn't celebrate because then immediately you're told this. And it just, hit me like a ton of bricks. I mean, I just couldn't believe it. And so then I'd taken the kids to school and contacted a high-risk doctor immediately. She got me in touch, and they saw me that afternoon. And we just get on the phone, start contacting everybody, start the prayer chain, So you just start networking and everybody just telling everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So then I went to the high-risk doctor, and my husband had met me over there. And so they basically told us, we had twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome. It only affects identical twins and only about 15% of identical twins. It's a donor-recipient relationship with the baby. So one baby will be the donor and one will be the recipient. The donor baby usually suffers from anemia because mm-hmm. all of its nutrients are going to the recipient, which then has too much fluid, and the heart works like triple time than it's supposed to replenish that fluid.
Mm.
So usually the donor baby dies of anemia, and the recipient baby dies because the heart just gives out.
Wow.
And with that relationship, if the recipient baby dies, because they share those blood vessels, the sudden rush of blood goes to the donor baby. And then that baby would have a stroke and either die or suffer severe neurological problems. So they painted a very grim picture for us. That day, they went ahead and did an amnio reduction because in the last week, looking back on it now, I can tell when it began because I went from not looking pregnant to looking like I was 8 months pregnant in the course of like 10 days.
Whoa.
So they took about, I think, a liter and a half to 2 liters off my stomach, just to kind of tell you how much water I had on me, because my back was hurting. I couldn't breathe. And, you know, mm-hmm. it was just hard. I just thought, well, it's just because I'm having twins. But it was more to it than that. Mm-hmm. So they took that off, did the amniotic reduction. So I was able to breathe, you know, so much better. So then what do? You go home and start Googling it. And mm-hmm. I just sat and just cried and cried and cried. because it's not, there is not a lot of, you know, it's about 60% that both babies are going to make it. But they say, you know, there's a high chance that they're going to have severe neurological problems. Mm-hmm. You know, and have handicaps and stuff like that. So it's not, you know, it's very devastating. So that time, then we got in touch. They got us in touch with the Fetal Care Center of Cincinnati Children's. Went up there, and I had like an MRI and had EKG on the babies and ultrasound, and they did all kinds of testing. And then my in-laws were with me and my husband and myself. And we go in this big room. It's like a big, long, something you see on, like, Discovery Health. Like, this is something that's never going to happen to you.
Mm-hmm.
So you go in there, and the MRI is up on the wall, and you got your extra. I mean, it's just wall-to-wall of all your stuff that they did for that day. And then there's, like, three doctors, a couple nurses and administrators. And when you walk in the room, you're just like, is this really happening to me? So then you sit down, and they give you all the options. And we were all sitting there. And they said, you know, you could selectively reduce one of the babies, which would be Macy, because she was a recipient and having heart problems.
When they say selectively reduce, they're talking about mm-hmm. aborting that child.
Kill her.
Yes.
Kill her,
mm-hmm.
yes. And that's what I said.
Mm-hmm.
We're not going to kill baby B. At that time, it was baby B.
mm-hmm.
We're not going to do that. And so then they said, and then you could, and at this point, they stage you at 1 through 4, and I was at a stage 2 at that mm-hmm. point. You know, 1's the best place to be, and 4 is the worst. So I was at a stage 2.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, you know, you could terminate the pregnancy, which I'm like, okay, kill both of them. That's not an option for us.
Mm-hmm.
And then, or you could do nothing, and then baby B, which would be Macy, would die for sure. And then when that happens, you know, she would bleed into Emma, which was our donor baby, and she could have a stroke and or death or suffer neurological problems. They said you could just continue to do amniotic reductions, which I'd already had one of those, and the fluid came back within 5 days.
Wow.
At that point, I was at like 21 weeks. And every time you do an amniotic reduction, you go in there, and there's a risk of infection. There's a risk of getting you going into labor.
Mm.
So at that point, if I was closer to the end, that might have been a feasible option. But being that I was just halfway through a pregnancy, you know, that wasn't an option because, again, you know, Macy would die for sure. And then you could do the laser ablation surgery. Me and my husband didn't even talk about it. We just said, we're going to do the laser surgery because that gives both of our babies a chance at life.
Mm-hmm.
We have to do, as parents, we have to do what's best to give them both a chance.
Right.
There's no terminating, there's no however you want to medically term the word, but we're not killing our babies.
Mm-hmm.
So the only thing that we felt like that would give them both a chance was the surgery. It was experimental, and insurance didn't cover it. And I remember when I made that appointment, you know, the insurance lady was asking me, I was like, you know what? I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care if they don't cover it. We're having the surgery. You know, it's like,
yeah.
I'll pay this loan for the rest of my life, but we're having it. So I don't even want to talk about insurance. So at that point, you know, we scheduled it for the following Tuesday, which would have been a week later, because the main doctor that does it, he was speaking at a conference in Washington. I mean, I knew it was serious, but your mind just can't comprehend how serious it is all at one time. But, you know, we had everybody praying, doing as much praying as we could. And so they said, we'll come back Friday because we have to put you through, like, pre-op. So they had to do EKG on me, you know, make sure I was good for surgery. Went through all the testing, and they did EKGs and measured, like, stuff on the babies, their cords and their hearts and all that stuff, like the blood flow through the cord. We get back to the room, we're waiting for the doctor, and he comes in, and he's like, well, you've went from stage 2 to stage 4.
Oh, my goodness.
And twin-to-twin can change. And a moment's notice, it doesn't give you any warning. They have no idea why. They don't know what causes twin-to-twin. It just happens. and there's no way to know how it's going to progress. That's why you have to be monitored, and there needs to be so much more awareness about this. Twin-to-twin kills more babies than SIDS, but I had never heard of twin-to-twin transfusion, and nobody I knew had heard of it either.
Mm-hmm.
But everybody knows what SIDS is. So it progressed from 2 to 4, and they're like, if you don't have surgery in 24 hours, most people die.
Wow.
So they called the surgeon, the main surgeon, and he flew back early from his conference to do surgery on me on Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord, he did that.
Yes.
The one question that like haunted me out of this whole thing, because, you know, we had made our decision and everything, and then right before we're getting ready to leave to head back home, the one little doctor comes in, he goes, and I just want you to know, once we go in there, that if the placenta share is not fairly equal, I mean, it can be a little off, but like 60, 40, 30, anything less than, I guess, 30, 35%, then basically you're going to be cutting off one of their life support and nutrients. But there's no way to know that going in. And so I'm just like, me and my mother-in-law cried silently the whole entire way back to the house. Because it didn't change our decision, but I just prayed that that wasn't the case, because then I would have felt like, you know, it was our fault. I know that sounds really silly, but basically, you know, me giving them the okay would have cut off one of my babies. It could have, you know, so that was just haunting to me. And that's all I could think about until the surgery. So we just prayed as much as we could. And then Saturday, before me and my husband left for the surgery, we prayed. David's brother was up here, and we had kind of gathered around and prayed. And then me and David left, and then kind of everybody else came up closer to when the surgery was going to be. My whole family is like my mom, dad, my sister, nephews, David's brother, mom and dad. There's a lot of people. And he's like, I didn't know you brought, you know, you had a whole entourage with you to surgery. I'm like, yeah, because we have really good family support. And everybody, you know, gathered around the bedside, and we just prayed. And my son, he's 14, and he's not real Mr. Emotional or anything. And I just remember him staring at me, and his lower lip just kind of quivering a little bit. So that's the first time I've really kind of seen him ready to cry. It was just like we were just thrown into this, and I mean, it's just like something you see on TV. That's never going to happen to me.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you're living it. We had been taken to pre-op, and David was the only one with me at that point, and everybody's getting ready, and I just told him, I'm like, you know, I just really feel like we need, because we went back and forth about names. I'm like, I want these girls to have a name before I go back there, because I want you all to be praying for them by name. Sorry, I'm getting all choked up.
Out
in the waiting room.
Mm-hmm.
It was just very important for them to have a name and them to be praying for them by name. So we decided on, you know, Emma Grace and Macy Faith and their middle names, you know, just because of the journey, regardless of what the outcome was going to be at that point, because there was a good chance they could have died during surgery or even shortly after. There's always that risk. So we had went in there, and they were out there praying, and there was a whole slew of doctors and nurses and anesthesiologists, I mean, just everywhere. So I remember the anesthesiologist, he's like, honey, is there anything I can do for you? And that's the last thing I remember. And I said, you just pray for my babies. Pray for my girls. Mm-hmm. And that's the last thing I remembered before I went to sleep. And then when I woke up, the first word out of my mouth was, what is the placenta share? I mean, come out from sedation, what is the placenta share? He was like, it's good. I was like, praise the Lord. That's exactly what I said.
Yay.
Because that was just so scary.
Mm-hmm.
So scary. And those are some hard decisions. So then, you know, everything was good. They survived surgery. They took a couple liters again off my stomach. They lasered 23 blood vessels that connected the girls. Before my surgery, he was like, the worst that we've seen around here is about 6 blood vessels. And so I had 23. I was like, well, if I'm going to do it, I'm just going to do it right, I guess. And then they poke tiny holes in Emma, our donor baby's sac, so fluid can kind of flow. Because before, like initially for the first ultrasound, you couldn't even see anything but the top of her head because she didn't have enough fluid, so it was like her sack was wrapped around her like cellophane.
Ooh.
You couldn't see anything but the top of her head. I stayed there overnight, and then the next morning, all three doctors came in. They were in there doing the ultrasound, and, you know, we're just waiting on the, you know, you're looking for those heartbeats on the screen,
yes.
And they both were there, and you could already see signs of improvement. That was about 21 and a half weeks when I had surgery, and, of course, you know, they give you the one little doctor just preached to me, you got to be on bed rest, you can't do this, you can't do that, you got to, 28 weeks, you know, they just, like, beat that into my head.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm a very active person, so for me to be on bed rest was really hard. But you got to do what you got to do.
Right.
And the last time I went to Cincinnati, they just were so impressed at how well they did. And, I mean, it's all because of the prayers. I mean, I don't know how people get through these things without God. It was such a horrible time for us. And without having God to lean on, I don't know how people can get through it, you know?
Yeah.
And, we're so thankful for all the prayers and the family that helped and everything. But I know my daughter had sent out an email kind of, because she was there and she kind of was picking up on different things. And she had sent out an email, you know, asking everybody to pray for her mom and her sisters, you know, just shows that she knew what to do too. She know where to go.
Mm-hmm.
And that's prayer, you know, that's the only thing we could do at that point, because we couldn't do anything about it. It was all in God's hands. They were born at 35 weeks in 2 days.
Wow.
And they came on their own. I didn't have to be induced. They never were on any breathing assistance. The most trouble they had was keeping their body temperature. So they were in isolate. Macy was in the NICU for 7 days. And
mm-hmm.
she was the one that was, you know, 24 hours from death. And then Emma was in there for 10 days.
Wow.
No problems. Smart. This can be. No delays at all. And to look back and think, you know, what other people who don't have their faith in God might have chose, and to see
mm-hmm.
what they're missing out on,
yeah.
you know. And it's scary. And when I went there, they gave me a booklet that probably weighed about 3 pounds to look through. And when we got home, I'm like, I'm not looking at this, because it's not going to change my decision.
Mm-hmm.
We decided it's not changing anything. So looking through that is only going to add more stress and worry. So I just pitched it.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't even look at it. For people to say there's no life, or, you know, they're just a fetus, or however they want to say it. When I went in for those ultrasounds, because I was having them every week, and you would watch, and he would be getting ready to check Emma. Well, Macy would go up and punch her. And he'd have to, like, start all over. And he goes, I can't wait to meet this kid. And then it was like she would turn and look at you. I mean, and this didn't happen just one time. It was every time. They would start pressing on the tummy, and they start messing with their sister. And she'd go up, and she'd just start hitting her sister. And I'm like, and people say there's no God. I mean, this baby has her personality. And I was 20 weeks pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
And she is her personality. And I know it's because. If she wasn't the way she is now, I know she wouldn't have made it. You know, she is a little pistol, let me tell you. But she has that fire in her belly, and I know that's what pulled her through, you
mm-hmm.
know, what she went through, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what amazes me the most, is I'm thinking people say, oh, well, there's just a fetus. Or I was 20 weeks pregnant, and that's not very far along. And she's doing this stuff. I mean, that shows logic and thinking, and, you know, I mean, they are just a little human in there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they can't survive on their own out here, but they are, you know, I mean, I'm totally, there is life at conception, and
mm-hmm.
under no means would I ever terminate a pregnancy. And I was at work maybe in the summer, and we got on the subject of somehow abortion and all that stuff. And the one lady was like, well, you know, she kind of thinks it's a woman's choice. She's like, well, what if you were in a medical, if it was medically, it would kill you or your babies? Or I said, well, you know, I kind of went through something like that. And I said, I still chose to do what's best to save my babies, even though I had 2 older children. And I knew I possibly could die. And I just chose not to think about that. I was too focused on the babies. And I'm like, you know, I did. I went through that. And I chose to do what I could for my babies. And so that, because they've been in some articles, the girls have, and some local papers.
Mm-hmm.
And so I pulled out one of my magazines they were in and showed her. And she was just like, really? She was like, man, you know, so.
What a good witness.
Yeah.
Why was it so important to you to have Emma's and Macy's story known?
Well, just the fact that, you know, I had never heard of this and had my doctors, because there's a lot of doctors that aren't properly educated on this, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And it just, for one, it's a miracle story, you know, of what God did for us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know there's a lot of other families that don't have the same outcome. There's like the Twin to Twin Transfusion Foundation page on Facebook, and I can't even hardly get on there because there was one mom on there, like I looked a couple weeks ago, and she's like, yeah, basically she lost one of hers. She had the surgery and lost one of hers. So mm-hmm. she was going to be delivering one baby and then one stillborn baby. And so she was mm-hmm. talking about funeral arrangements and all that stuff. And it just, I mean, it mm-hmm. just, I just bawl because I'm like, that could have been us. You know,
yeah,
you
could have
think that. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't. But, you know, you just, my heart is so heavy for those that aren't as fortunate as I was. And I don't know why God chose this for us. I'm so thankful that he did. And I just have felt, ever since it's happened, I felt like we're supposed to be spreading the word about what happened to them, you know.
Mm-hmm.
God brought us through this and gave us two beautiful, healthy girls. And
he deserves the glory
for
what he did. Absolutely, yes.
And I tell, anytime I can, I tell the story to somebody. And I tell it, I don't leave out any God parts either. I mean, I tell it just like I told it now.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, if you can create more awareness for it, too, you know, you can help save babies. Anytime you have identical twins, you're at risk for it, and it can happen anytime.
Really?
Anytime during the pregnancy. So if you went to the doctor and they say, oh, you're having twins, well, they need to check to see if they're identical or not. Then you just need to be watched. You know, you need to do ultrasounds.
Mm-hmm.
One thing, you know, which I know now, but I didn't know at the time because I had no idea about any of this, was the massive, like, 10-pound in a week weight gain,
mm-hmm.
you know, going from not looking pregnant to looking like you're about to deliver, you know, just, and then the severe back pain that went along with that sudden gain, just all fluid,
mm-hmm.
fluid gain. And I mean, it can just happen just like that. So, you know, if you can create some awareness.
So basically, you would encourage parents who find out they're having twins, especially if they're identical, to keep getting checked so that mm-hmm. if this develops, they can hopefully do something to help their babies both survive.
Yes, and immediately, if you're diagnosed with that, you know, or even if they tell you you're having identical twins, I mean, it's not going to hurt to go to a high-risk doctor, like mm-hmm. a maternal fetal medicine that specializes in that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Because it can go from not having TTTS to a week later, you can have it. And depending on where you're at in the pregnancy, like after 25 weeks, they don't do the surgery. So there's mm-hmm. there's different things you can do depending on when you're diagnosed.
Tell us about your family now. You got four children.
Yes.
Four beautiful children, and
the
they're all healthy.
Are five now. They are perfect.
Mm-hmm.
They are perfect. They keep us going, that is for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. Their older sister, Kristen, is 16. She started driving this year.
Mm-hmm.
And their older brother, Michael, is 19, and he joined the Air Force. They are doing good. And anytime we can tell our story or get the opportunity, we want to. I have a website, and I have a page designated kind of for that, for them, the Twin to TTTS, that tells their story. But I do want to go and tell their story and give women hope or create awareness. I want to do that because I definitely feel like this happened to us for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
And it's to spread the word and show what God can do. I mean, because
okay.
we were devastated.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was, that's been the lowest point in our lives. And, you know, to have hope and to know that you can lean on God and he can bring you through this. And you don't have to terminate somebody.
That's right. That's right. And, you know, he is sovereign, and learning to trust him, I know, in a situation like that is really, really tough, but we've got to trust him because he knows what he's doing.
Yes, definitely. And I know because I was a mess, and then at like 28 weeks, I was just like, you know what? I can't keep doing this. I cannot keep worrying. They're going to be fine. We're going to be fine. And I just gave it. At that point, I was like, God, you got to take this because I can't take it anymore. At that point, you know, I just gave it over to him, and I quit worrying about it. You had to turn it over because you can't carry that stuff alone.
That's right. Where can people find you online?
Well, you could go to, I do have a website. It's www.dawnstonephotography.com. And I have the girls' story on the, my TTTS page. But I update my Facebook, and I'm going to be making a Facebook page for them, for their story. Mm-hmm. But you can go to my Facebook. It's Dawn Stone Photography. You can send me an email if you have questions, if you know somebody that's having twins, anything like that. You know, feel free to contact me because I'm more than happy to share any information because there is hope. And, you know, when I went and Googled stuff, there wasn't a lot of hope I didn't mm-hmm. see. So just know that there is hope for your babies and just being educated and praying. No doubt in my mind that God has big plans for these girls.
Oh, yes. I am sure.
I just look at them and I'm just like, even when they're driving me crazy and, you know, I'm just so thankful